In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory forever.
Good morning. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. These words are from St. Mark this morning, and they afford us the opportunity to meditate upon the gospel. We have four gospels within the New Testament, don't we? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And yet, we believe that there is only one gospel. When we announce these gospels that are read on Sunday mornings, we do not say that there are four gospels, if we pay close attention, right? But we say that this is the gospel, according to St. Mark. Or on another Sunday, according to St. John, or St. Luke, or St. Matthew. But it's good for us to get back to the basics and to understand what the gospel is. And so, as part of this meditation, I'd just like to ask three questions. What is the gospel which affords us? What is not the gospel? So we'll speak about what the gospel is not, what the gospel is in the universal sense, and what the gospel is to us personally. Those three things. First, what the gospel is not. First of all, the gospel is not just one more religion. My teacher, Father Alexander Schmemann, would say this quite frequently when I was a student, that our Lord Jesus Christ did not die on the cross so that he might just institute another Christian religion. As a matter of fact, what he taught us is that with the death of Christ upon the cross, we have the fulfillment of all religion. Because in Christ, there is no more need for religion. What do people today think about religion? They think about it in rather negative or pejorative ways, don't they? I'm not a religious person. I'm somebody, but I'm kind of spiritual. I'm not into organized religion. How many of us have heard that before? I know I have quite a few times. I don't believe in organized religion. Well, come to the Orthodox Church because this is the most unorganized religion on the face of the earth. No, really, it's not religion. What is religion? Religion is about rules and rituals. Rules and rituals, right? Some of those rules are important. For example, the Ten Commandments. Those are given to us by God. And if we live according to the Ten Commandments, then what those commandments do for us internally is they cleanse our hearts. They cleanse our minds and they allow us to begin this journey of faith. But most people today think of religion as rules and rituals, and as a kind of afterlife life insurance that gets us into the kingdom of God when we die. But nothing could be further from the truth than what the gospel teaches about the gospel. What the religion is again a way of affirming for ourselves this false notion that we can be good enough in God's eyes by keeping all of these rules and all of these rituals. What the gospel is not is also pop psychology. The best religion, the best kind of Christianity these days is a type of watered-down Christianity. Very, very popular. We find it, as a matter of fact, in most of the so-called mega churches. And in my mind, the very notion or the very idea of a mega church is heresy, right? It's heresy. There is the church which is the body of Christ, or there is nothing. You can't make the church greater than it already is. You see where I'm going with this? But it's not pop psychology. And people today have taken the gospel and have reduced it to kind of this feel-good spirituality, and that's where I'm going with this. How many of us come to church on a Sunday morning and we leave not feeling so good about ourselves? I hope that's the truth, because it's the truth with me. that when I come and hear the word of God, when we pray the liturgy, we sometimes go home with this sense of, I've got a lot of work to do in my lives. We sometimes are given a positive guilt. You know, not all guilt is a bad thing. If we turn guilt into shame, that can be a problem. But there is such a thing as good guilt, and that guilt motivates us to pray to God for change. And certainly, I think our culture today needs a little bit more of that brutal gospel message, that it's not about feeling good about ourselves so necessarily. Maybe we need less of that and more of the words of what we heard from St. John the prophet this morning, who says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. The Lord is here right now, and we cannot afford to miss this opportunity that he gives us in order to receive his saving word. So what the gospel is not? The gospel is not religion. The gospel is not pop psychology, right? And this is very important for us to understand. What is the gospel? In St. Paul's letter to the Romans, he says this. He says that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation unto everyone who believes, both Jew and Greek. And in this sense, the gospel becomes more than a story, even. The gospel itself is the presence of Christ here, who by his destruction of death is giving us this opportunity to follow him down this narrow path that leads into the kingdom of God. The gospel is the power of Christ who destroys the death that we carry inside each of our hearts so that his life might come into all of us. This is the gospel. It's about Christ, the good news about Christ and his victory over sin, death, and the devil. And this is why on this Sunday before Theophany every year, we read the story about John the Baptist in the desert preaching, as Isaiah foretells, prepare the way of the Lord. Because we follow Christ himself as a new Adam into these baptismal waters, so that through these waters, through these sacred waters, we might be cleansed and we might then put on the new man. And this is finally the answer to our third question. What does it mean for the gospel to live in us? And here we again have St. Paul, a passage, a verse from his letter to the Philippians, where he says this, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. So, the gospel in us means that we die to self. We die to self so that Christ can abide within us, so that Christ can come to life inside of us. And that dying is very important. Every day, we drown the old Adam. How do we do this? How do we do this? We drown the old Adam in the waters of our own baptism. Every day we have that gift of being able to do that, to overcome our own sins, to overcome our own passions, through prayer and through self-denial, through faith and through love for our Lord Jesus Christ. If we can die to self, to that old corrupt self, then Christ will come alive inside of us and the gospel will become something real. And this is a beautiful thing. And this is why whenever we hear the word gospel in the Orthodox Church, evangelion, we rejoice at this word, because everything that we need to know about how we are saved is embodied in that beautiful, powerful word. My own intuition, my own guess is that we have four gospels, because the Gospels were written in the first century in a Greco-Roman culture, which remembered and even lauded and even worshipped this great hero, the greatest of all classical heroes, whose name was Alexander the Great. He was the archetypal hero because he was victorious. He established this great empire for the first time on the face of the earth. We hear about the Roman Empire, correct? But actually, it was the Roman Empire that inherited whose empire? Alexander's empire. And how did he establish this empire? Through military victory, through a show of strength like none other on the face of the earth, at least during that time. And guess how many narratives, how many biographies existed from what we know in the first century about the life of Alexander the Great? Four. There were four biographies of Alexander the Great. And my belief is that we have to do a little bit more research on this, is that the church presents us four gospels as a type of anti-hero. For who? For Christ. Because he is not victorious over earthly armies, over earthly generals. He is victorious over death, sin, and the devil. And this is why we believe that the gospel, as St. Paul says, is the power unto salvation to everyone who believes. So may God bless us with these words this morning. And remember, what a great gift this one single term, Evangelion, the gospel of God in Christ Jesus. What a great gift has been given to us in this teaching. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.